What's up, everybody? Lee and Tammy Sanders. You're checking out a new Wrestling with the Topics. At the time we're recording this, it is Sunday of June 12th, 2022, but we have the intent of releasing this during the week of June 13th. So what a great way to kick off the start of a new week and officially the return of me doing all the shows that you guys have come to know, love, and appreciate. I hope you guys had a fantastic weekend. Actually, we both hope that you all had a fantastic weekend. At the time that we're recording this, Tams, you're getting ready to go back to work literally within less than 24 hours. I am still on a extended vacation period, at least from my night job, not so much as the other stuff that I have my hands dipped into, but my night gig, as they fucked up once again with my schedule. I actually got to touch base with them and let them know, hey, you guys overshot that. You actually were supposed to bring it back this week. I mean, unless they're going to pay me, then it's a different story. But yes, this is the first show that we have done since the last show we put out, which was around the final week of May. I'm looking at the calendar right now, and the last show that was put out, actually, no, we did a show on June 1st. I remember coming on after AEW Dynamite had went off the air. So yeah, the last show I had did for you guys was on Wednesday, June 1st. And I've pretty much been done since then. No shows since then. So it's nice to be doing this. Obviously, if you're connected to us all throughout social media, then you know that there was a lot of fun stuff that had went down these past 2 weeks, pretty much. Of course, we had made our return to the nation's capital of Washington, D.C. to cover Awesome Con. And that was, I always mix the numbers up. That was our fifth consecutive year, right?
Yes.
Fifth consecutive year, because we did 2017. Everything started with 2017. Mm-hmm. And then we did 2018. Mm-hmm. We did 2019. Mm-hmm. There was no 2020. Mm-hmm. We did 2021. And then mm-hmm. we just did 2020. So five consecutive years we have been invited as members of the media to cover Awesome Con, and always fantastic of an experience as always. But this go round, and you and me, we couldn't sing enough praises about this. It was nice to see that there was more emphasis on Artist Alley. It was nice to see really good, strong representation of Artist Alley from various artists, whether it's publishers or, you know, graphic artists, you know, sculptors, designers, mm-hmm. you name it. I loved what we had saw that was on hand for this year's Awesome Con, as it was some of the best work I've seen to date. And I like that there wasn't that much of an overkill. There wasn't any overkill mm-hmm. when it came to the celebrities.
I agree. Well, even to be honest with you, overkill, not even with Artist Alley.
Yeah.
Because normally when we go, you probably have maybe 5 to 10 of each thing. And not that that's a bad thing. A lot of times it gets repetitive when you see it that way. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, there was a little bit of everything. And it was an overkill. And there was some new things that were there this year that we had not seen. And there's some very new concepts. There was one vendor that I really specifically enjoyed for myself, which was actually taking the cover of cereal boxes, but putting a character on it that wasn't the actual character. So, for example, you have Frosted Flakes. Well, we already know that Tony the Tiger is a spokes character for that brand. Instead of having Tony the Tiger, they had Tigger, and it was like a baby Tigger, and it was really cute. I mean, just some really, really inventive things that you would kind of never think about. And it was really nice to see. Very refreshing, because to be honest with you, some years we go and you have vendors there that you know really have absolutely no business being there. You know, their whole spiel of what they're trying to sell connects with nothing with Awesome Con.
That's a very good point. That is a very good point. I'm glad that you brought it up, because that's something that quietly I have noticed off and on over the years. And I don't want to single out a particular vendor, mm-hmm. particular individual. But to your point, yes, because there's been years, to echo what you said, even though literally it's the same thing, there were some things I noticed and I'm going, wait a minute, how does this even tie to Artist Alley? How does this even tie into everything that's coming about right now for this weekend? It kind of really mm-hmm. doesn't. It just really feels like you're just trying to whore yourself out here where, I mean, and this isn't a knock, but it would almost be as if, what the fuck is Avon and Mary Kay doing here? You know, it's almost kind of.
It's almost like that.
It's almost like that.
and you're like, this makes no sense. I mean, besides the fact that, okay, well, we might get a little something because there's a mass amount of people. Mm-hmm. But it's just like, okay, so someone who's interested, you know, in Frosted Flakes.
Frosted Flakes. Okay. Frosted Flakes. There you go.
Yes. Frosted Flakes.
You're struggling there.
So... you know, they would be interested in that. But yet you're over here trying to sell them, I don't know, Play-Doh. You know, it's like, well, wait a minute. This is my interest, but you have something that's like, I have no interest in whatsoever. Doesn't even come close to what I'm interested in. So I don't know. I just felt that that was a good change in a positive way in how they, you know, are listening to people in reference to their feedback for the event.
I'll see you and I'll raise you. It was also refreshing to see that, because let's be honest, in the years that we've covered AwesomeCon, we have seen some vendors, oh my God, these guys are here yet again. Mm-hmm. And you just go, it's one thing if it's a vendor and you go, yo, their stuff is banging. Mm-hmm. Happy to see these guys back here again. Oh, this is going to be awesome. Like, I'll tell you one vendor who I was looking forward to seeing this year, but I think because of everything that he's got going on down there in Florida and trying to finish building up his headquarters, get that where he needs it to be and everything. And plus, he's at a point right now where he really doesn't need to do the con events anymore. Not unless he wants to, and it's his way of connecting more with the fans on a personal level. But he's at a point right now in his professional career where he really doesn't need it. Signed by Superstars, which is helmed by Rob Feinstein. He really doesn't need to do that stuff anymore. But there were a couple of years, as far as vendors who, hey, I'm actually looking forward to mm-hmm. him, and there was no representation.
I actually was looking forward to him as well.
Yeah, there was no representation of him this year, which I was a little bit bummed about. But there were some vendors who I've seen over the years. I'm going, man, you guys are here again. And it's like, not for nothing, but past few times we've seen you guys, y'all ain't really got no action over here. Like, don't really know about that one. So I don't want to throw no shade at a particular individual, but for those of you that have frequented Awesome Cons, I mean, if you just honestly close your eyes and you just really think about it, I'm sure that you guys will probably say, yeah, you know, now that I'm thinking about it, I wasn't really feeling, I really wasn't sure why this person was there, or mm-hmm. you know. So I like the fact that There was a lot of fresh new faces mm-hmm. that were there at Artist Alley. And I tell you, I would be shocked to hear, well, you know, there actually were a few people that returned, because, and let me say it like this, I would be shocked to learn that there were a few people who returned and their shit is banging, and yet somehow we missed them. Like the brother that had all the artwork inspired, mm-hmm. you know, he pretty much had like him doing 3D. The Wakanda pose. Right. Yeah, mm-hmm. He's been there before.
Oh, yeah.
He just had a smaller joint. Mm-hmm. That's what that was. Mm-hmm. And now he was in a position where he was really able to freaking really explode. Mm-hmm. Right, right. So mm-hmm. I like that. I mm-hmm. like that. Of course, good food was there as well. Good food was there as well. By now, many of you guys know that we had did a panel on Friday. And it's so funny because I saw quite a few people in our Discord that we share under the Wrestling Soup Network banner. So shout out to the good folks over there at Wrestling Soup, my brother in arms, Anthony Missionary Thomas. And between Discord and Twitter, there were quite a few people that were saying, oh, I missed it. I didn't know the date and time. I missed it. And I'm thinking to myself, and Julian pretty much called him out on it too in his own nice little way. But I'm thinking, how the fuck could you miss it? You saw a poster that had our three faces on it. It told you it was the five W's. Who, what, when, where, why. It covered it all. What's the time? You got it. What's the date? You got it. Where's the location? You got it. Who's doing this? You got it. Okay? Okay. What's it about? You got it. Everything was crossed off. Everything was crossed off. Eastern, Pacific, everything was crossed off. I mentioned it on my shit. Julian mentioned it on his shit. Mish mentioned it on his shit. So there was just no way, unless you were just really, you're not a social media person, right? Usually when you make it be your rounds to check out a podcast, maybe you're doing it on your day off. I don't know if your day off is on a weekend and that's when, so you're catching up after the fact. I don't know, but it was hilarious because people were just right down to the point. We even had that girl afterwards who showed up. Yeah. Wearing the
she was bummed.
Oh, could you tell though? Because we actually had some people that could not believe that a girl, let alone nobody mentioned an attractive girl. I thought she was cute, by the way.
She was.
But some of the folks didn't believe that a girl actually showed up at the end of the panel, bummed that she missed the talk of. Our panel. Tell them about that.
Yeah. So we had, at that point, had ended up finishing packing up. We were getting ready to walk out. And actually a couple of people came up and in talk with Lee and Mish and Julian, just in reference to, you know, how they enjoyed the panel, so on and so forth. And at that point we were, you know, walking out and the girl came in and she said, oh my God, I'm so bummed. I missed everything. And, you know, she asked, you know, where she could get it to check it out, so on and so forth. And didn't she have an Adam Cole sweat jacket on?
Now, keep in mind that this is the first time that we're speaking about the whole Awesome Con experience. And there was only one time that the Adam Cole little jacket that she was wearing, it was kind of like a sweater. There was only one time that it was mentioned, and it was mentioned shortly after she left. And I think it was while we were eating dinner that maybe we mentioned it was at some point later that day.
But my point.
Mm-hmm. We've only talked about it since then, and that was almost 2 weeks ago.
Correct.
So the fact that you remember that still, right? Okay. Okay. Yes. She was actually pushing a Adam Cole attire.
Mm-hmm.
It almost kind of looked like something maybe she might have made herself, because if it turns out that's actually sold online somewhere, that's new to me, but it looked like something that she had put together and everything. But yeah, she legit was bummed out that she missed the panel. And there were quite a few people that were just, oh man, missed the panel. So I made sure that panel was available for everybody to check out as soon as humanly possible. I had a great time. It was an awesome 45 minutes of a panel. Now, let me let you guys in on a little bit of a secret. And I know that the good kind folks over there at Awesome Con, they'll usually make their rounds hearing what, you know, people had to say, especially those that are part of the media and, you know, talking about the overall experience and everything. If I had one piece of constructive criticism that I would forward to Awesome Con going forward, and this has to do with their panels, I did not appreciate the fact that, first of all, we got this guy, I don't even know his name, can't remember it now. I don't know if it was Austin or what, but we had this guy who
Otis Beefcake.
I don't know.
I'm being facetious, guys.
I don't know. Train of thought, though. Let me, because you know how my train of thought is. It's like once it's there and then least little thing is fucking gone.
So basically, he comes out.
So, yeah, because you're not seeing this because you're pretty much trying to get our pro badges. So me, Mish, and Julian, we're going over to the banner and we're taking a look at, you know, oh, where's our show? Oh, there it is. There it is right there in black and white. There's the time. And we're all nodding our head and we're pretty. Yeah, man. Look at this. All right now. Cool. Badass. And so this guy comes out, the guy that would ultimately be our go-to guy for if we needed anything as far as additional equipment. He would pretty much count us down when we had 10 minutes remaining, 5 minutes remaining, 2 minutes remaining, things of that nature. He's got a panel that's already underway. So, you know, we're showing up early. We're just minding our own business and we're just, you know, looking at the little 3D dimensional wall banner graphic, trying to see where our show is located and everything. And he comes out asking if he could help us. And we just, you know, Mish took the helm. He goes, oh, no, we're just here for our, what was it, 6:30. He's like, we're here for our 6:30 panel. We're just getting here early just to, you know, warm up and everything, get familiar with everything. And this guy basically would not allow us entry into the panel that was already at hand so that we could at least get an idea on where everything is and all that. He was very, very territorial. He came off very authoritative. Like he was really trying to put upon us his authority, right? So it was kind of, okay, whatever, dude, like whatever. And so he wouldn't allow us entry into the panel that was already at play. And let me tell you something. I've covered AwesomeCon enough over the years where if you're showing up for a panel 15 minutes before it ends, you're not going to get challenged. Nobody's going to come up to your face and go, yo, can I help you? Nobody's going to do that. They're just going to, you know, look at you, smile, and that's pretty much it. But if you have a panel that's upcoming, you're more than welcome to go up to the people that are going to be ultimately in charge of making sure you're good to go, you know, and say, hey, my name is Lee and I've got the 6:30 panel that's coming up. I'm just getting a look on where everything is. We'll talk after this panel is done. And they'll go, oh, yeah, OK, no problem. Sure, bet. Mm-hmm. Right. But this guy was so freaking authoritative. He was so freaking trying to impose his will on us. And it was kind of like, dude, you ain't impressing nobody here, okay? Well, little short guy. Anytime you got somebody that's shorter than me, that's a problem. That's and is a dick on top of that. So anyway, so I bring up this story because when it was all said and done, and we find out, okay, 45-minute panel. Well, it turns out the panel that was supposed to go on after us, which was basically at 7:30, it got canceled. And you would have thought that by default, oh, hey, Lee and crew, yeah, just got word that the 7:30 panel had canceled. So if you guys want to go ahead and you want to run an extra 15 minutes, I can give you guys an extra 15 minutes. It's no problem. That did not happen whatsoever. Okay. And it really would have been nice because we were actually prepared for a much longer show. We had it down to a 45-minute show, but there were a number of topics that we sadly were not able to get into that we wanted to get into during that panel. Mm-hmm. But because RoboCop wanted to make sure we got the fuck out of there on time, mm-hmm. it was just... So I think going forward for AwesomeCon, I think it would be really badass that, you know, hey, somehow it is communicated to their volunteer workers or just mm-hmm. workers in general that yep. when a panel pretty much somehow they pretty much get the word to, you know, OK, say, for example, the cameraman or lady, you know, hey, I don't know if one of them has a cell phone on them, but you can text them that they can go an additional 15 minutes or 20 minutes if they want, because we had a cancellation. Otherwise, I don't know, maybe I could hold up a sign or something to get their attention that they can go into overtime. They're OK. Mm-hmm. And we'll give them a new countdown, something along those lines, you know, because if the guys that's at the panel, if they're willing to go longer, right? And in addition to that, if we're not using their equipment, like a projector screen and all that other stuff. Right,
that they would have to break down,
right,
or whatever.
Right. Yep. Then just tell us, hey, you guys can go into a little bit of OT. We're going to actually go on ahead and we're kind of needed elsewhere. So mm-hmm. we'll just make sure you guys wrap up at the time that you're supposed to wrap up.
Right.
And, right. If they would have operated in that type of fashion, that mm-hmm. would have been badass. Because, you know, as good as everybody felt the panel was, we all were bummed out that, man, that was so short, because we were really, you could see playing it back, you could see we were really starting to build up some great chemistry together. I mean, it was intact from the very first minute, but just as the show went on, it was getting better and better and mm-hmm. better. Not mm-hmm. that it sucked at any time, because it didn't. It was just getting better and better and better, and then it was just, that's it. You know, it's kind of mm-hmm. like putting in an album, you're not really sure what to expect, and then you're like, man, this is a banger, and you go, wait, that's it?
Right.
Man, this was a short ass EP or whatever, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, but despite that, I still had a great time doing the panel. I really, really, I told them both privately in conversations, but I really, really, I know we both do. So on behalf of the Sanders, we both really appreciate the hell out of Missionary Agreed. Thomas and Julian Cannon for coming up to DC. And I mean, Mish didn't even... As far as I know, Mish did not even check out any shit during Awesome Con weekend. He pretty much panel and out. Julian was literally panel and out. As far as mm-hmm. I know, he didn't even shop for anything at Arliss Alley, none of that. Because I asked both of them, I said, are you guys staying overnight? What's going on? And Julian was like, nah, I'm out of here first thing in the morning. I'm going, mm-hmm. damn. And Mish was pretty much the same thing. Mish was going to be going up to PA, and he already had his itinerary down and everything. So, but yeah, that whole AwesomeCon weekend, it was great. Particularly, I loved the panel. I loved hanging out with my guys, and we're already talking about doing it again next year. And trust me when I say we're definitely going to work out some fine kinks as far as itinerary go and all that. I definitely was bummed that we did not have a good place in mind for barbecue ribs and chicken, because it didn't dawn on me until after the fact. Oh, wait a minute. Yeah, me and Mish were talking about good place for ribs, because he was like, what's DC known for? And I know I said cupcakes, but I also said we're also known for our ribs. We're also known for, you know, for our barbecue.
Mm-hmm.
We're also known for our hot dogs because of Ben's Chili Bowl. So we're known for our chili, mm-hmm. Our hot dogs. We're also known for our mumbo sauce, because mumbo sauce Agreed. Had started, you know, first thing out here and everything. So I was bummed out, because when we got done doing Awesome Con, Mish he's been documenting over the last couple of shows from this past week. He's done a fantastic job chronicling, but there's a B-side to that vinyl record, folks. There's a B-side. Everything he's saying is accurate.
Oh boy.
Is accurate. But there's a B-side to that vinyl record as well. So we get done with Awesome Con, you know, with the panel on Friday. And look, by now, y'all should know, as far as how everything else had went during the weekend, if you didn't show it love already, go check out the YouTube playlist, youtube.com/the RCWR show. And there is a fantastic video highlights package about the sights, the sounds, the people, everything that you had missed during Awesome Con weekend. I got, you know, look, I'm not sucking my own dick here, okay? But I would have to say that I must have went through about a couple of hours of Awesome Con footage that, you know, we had accumulated from the weekend. And it was a matter of, okay, we got these couple of hours. Now let's get this down. Let's trim it down to about a 13-minute video or less. My goal was 10 minutes. I wanted to hit 10, but I wanted to be under 15 for what I was trying to show. And so for what I was able to put together, I loved it. I loved it. And it was in the best quality humanly possible, audio-wise, video-wise. So I loved that. I also had uploaded a a mystery box unveiling for Cobra Kai. It was like a Cobra Kai mystery box. And there were a couple of people that actually I reached out to me. They were like, yo, that Cobra Kai box is pretty badass. I actually dig that. One person said, yo, I'm jealous of some of the stuff you got in that Cobra Kai box, man. I'm like, hey, cool, you know, because me and Tams talked about it after the fact, right? See, we didn't talk about this anywhere else. When I say there's a B-side to the A-side vinyl, yeah, this is part of that B-side. So when we got done doing that Cobra Kai unboxing, I said to Tams, I said, yo, I don't know how much you paid for this, but your ass got gypped because, yo, this all looks kind of, you know, it's all right, but man, where's a signed autograph? Where's a Funko Pop figure? Where's a fucking piece of artwork? Like, how much did you pay for this? Shit,
signatures, 8x10 and signatures of all the actors mm-hmm. that are in Cobra Kai.
Well, you ain't gonna get that.
Well, I ain't say it had to be authentic. I'm talking about like a reprint.
Okay. I was gonna say, yeah. Nah, that's more doable. Yeah. That's more doable. Yeah. I'm like, man, you got gypped. Like, if you paid $50 for this, and it turns out she paid more for it, and I just was going, ew. I'm like, nah, it ain't for a duffel bag, a jet gel rag, some fucking wristbands,
a headband,
a iron on sticker.
Mm-hmm.
All that little jacket
patch.
Yeah, all that for.
So, mind you, oh, and a water bottle. Mind you, the duffel bag has already been jacked. I'm cool with it. I just wanted the water bottle, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, I agree with you.
Because it turns out that mystery box is available online for a price tag anywhere between $20 to $35, just under $40. And so mm-hmm. the fact that Tams paid a lot more than that, she got gypped, man. She got gypped. But I was saying to her afterwards, I was like, after we were done recording, because, you know, you see the review and it's like, oh, wow, you know, we're all excited. Man, I waited until that joint was over. I'm like, dude, you got conned. I was like, but I had to keep a straight face because you never know who might be watching, because somebody might be watching and they go, oh, wow, I really like the way that they are commenting on this. I like the way that they're reviewing this. I definitely want to reach out to them and see if they'd be willing to, you know, maybe review my product. So you always kind of want to leave. You always kind of want to leave the door open for potential partnerships and all of that. So mm-hmm. so that's why, because, and look, not for nothing, I did think some of the items were cool. Like, for me personally, to Tam's point, the duffel bag I thought was cool. I looked at that duffel bag and I said, shit, like, if we're packing to do a little something, right? In my case, I used it just a couple of days after AwesomeCon because I had to do some stuff at my college campus. I had to turn in some documentation. And so I wanted to make sure the documentation was going to be on point. So I ended up using the duffel bag for my documentation. So is that the puppy? Is that the puppy that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Boy, she is. Our puppy has been gassy the past couple of days.
Oh, yeah, probably.
Good God almighty. Okay, anyway. So we had that go down, right? And then, so here's where the fun begins. So after AwesomeCon, you know, Mish is like, hey, I wasn't sure if you guys had any plans. Figured maybe we can go grab a bite to eat. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, I got Rampage over at the 411 Mania site that I gotta, you know, pretty much do my live coverage, do my write-up and all that. Like, we can grab a bite, we can grab a drink. I'm thinking this is gonna be fucking easy peasy. I'm thinking, where you guys wanna eat? And they're going, just anywhere. And I know Mitch was like, didn't you say something about ribs? And I'm going, I think so. Yeah. Like, but you know, what do you guys got a taste for? And his brother is just going, man, we're just hungry. We just need to eat. And I'm thinking to myself, well, they have done a lot of driving. So mm-hmm. I'm thinking, okay, well, you know what? We can pretty much find any and everything in Adams Morgan in Northwest DC. Like anybody that frequents DC, resides in the DMV, they know about Adams Morgan and they can back me up. There are so many places to choose from to eat down in Adams Morgan, right down to there being clubs and all kinds of shit, right? You want to go get your drink on, right? You want to enjoy that nightlife, all that good stuff, right? It's banging. You're going to find all that and then some. So go on ahead. You know, he pops up after about, I felt like this guy was gone for maybe 30 minutes. It felt like the guy was gone.
At least 15 or 20.
It's like, damn, did this guy get lost? Like, what the hell's going on here? We thought he got lost. I'm tripping, not mugged. But no, seriously, we thought he got lost or something. Or maybe he couldn't figure out where exactly he parked the ride and all that. So we had a little bit of a delay there because that time frame was critical for us getting into Adams Morgan in the time frame that we wanted to get to and all that.
Remember, and anybody who knows Adams Morgan in D.C., a Friday night in Adams Morgan, anything after 6 o'clock,
because, see, we got out of that panel at 7:15, and we were already out on the streets by 7:30, mm-hmm. and we didn't see Mish until at least almost 8 o'clock. And so my mentality, you know, because those were my old stomping grounds, the later it's getting, the more difficult it's going to be.
True.
That's always been my mindset.
True.
Because I used to frequent that area a lot by foot when I was growing up out there and everything, when I lived over there and everything. So, but I'm thinking, okay, you know, we should be good. Like, okay, it's still relatively early. We should be all right. So we do this drive going to Adams Morgan. And a couple of times there, Tams is missing her turn. And she's missing her turn because she's basically relying on me to pretty much let her know, okay, hey, in about 300 feet, you got to turn. And some people can listen to Google and, okay, all right, cool. So, for example, in 1,000 feet, turn right on to. And so for some people, it's okay. I know I need to start getting ready. And, you know, and sometimes when it comes to Tams will be saying to herself out loud, okay, so am I doing it here? I noticed with Tams, I don't know how you guys are, you guys that drive, you could sound off. But with Tams, what I notice is when somebody is riding shotgun with her, she will rely more on the person to direct her rather than Google. I don't know why, but I've always noticed that. And maybe it's just because you want to have the anticipation to give you an out, a legit out. Maybe it's because you want to have the anticipation squashed even better so that if they're getting ready to say to you, hey, in 1,000 feet, you need to turn right. Maybe you kind of want to know about that, you know, maybe not necessarily seconds beforehand, but maybe a minute beforehand. That's how it kind of comes off.
Uh-huh. Okay. So let me be a little bit more clear, possibly a little bit. You have a point, but anybody who has ever driven in DC knows that you just can't make sudden decisions because you've got asshole to asshole traffic that's coming behind you, beside you, and in front of you. So that 500 feet to make a right sometimes just isn't possible. And then when you have somebody who is essentially following you, so you're now thinking of, okay, I've got to do this, but now I've got to figure out how I'm going to get them to be where I am as well. Now, I will tell you that for me, in reference to Google, I'm used to not only hearing it, but seeing it. So when you're over there with Google and just telling me, first of all, I can't see it, number one. Number two, sometimes those directions for me don't come as fast as I would like them to, especially for DC driving. So We had a very adventurous travel to Adams Morgan. You know, poor Mish, God bless him. We lost him at least three times. I scared the shit out of Lee and him.
And his brother.
And his brother. So I scared the shit out of three people and pretty much was trying to be as considerate as possible and giving them room. So I'm speeding up. And so they think I'm driving like a bat out of hell. So, and all in all, everybody was safe. Everybody was fine. But my apologies.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and, you know, suburban driving versus DC driving is a whole different beast. It is. It just, it's like going from Maryland to New York. And you have to have a whole separate set of driving skills for each. Mm. I mean, driving in New York and driving in, well, New York is a little worse because it's so much more congested. But just those two areas and driving in the city, you know, with people cutting you off, people, I mean, it's their own set of rules, you know. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we ended up getting to Adams Morgan. And Lee's like, yeah, great. We're here. Wonderful. Where are we going to park? I don't know. So we get to this. Oh, look. So we ride around the block past the first time we were supposed to get into the parking garage, go back around, get back to the spot. And then we go in the garage and there's no parking. None. I mean, none. So at this point, about 10 minutes after the second round of dang, there ain't no parking, we get a text from Mish's brother or Mish and say, food.
Yeah, that came after we arrived in Georgetown. So we lost about 50 minutes driving into Adams Morgan. Mm-hmm. That was just how heavy the traffic was for a Friday night, especially coming from the convention center and you're going to Adams Morgan. That's just how congested it was. So combine that with the fact that we were driving around at least three times in circles, trying to see if we could find some type of street parking. And then when we did notice, oh, hey, there's a P joint. Okay, P, public parking. Okay, let's go over there. Because we missed it the first rodeo, but we were trying to see if we could find some type of street parking to balance it out, and we couldn't. And so to the point, when we made the turn into what we thought was going to be public parking, the valet guy pretty much was just directing us, and we're kind of going, okay, he's hooking us up. We're going to go to an area, and then we're cutting through the alley. We're still in the alley. We're going through here. We're going through there. We're like, okay, where's the garage already? And then next thing you know, we're back out on the street, the main street. And it was, oh, okay, guess they don't have any more parking. I'm like, okay, cool. And so I call Mission them up. I'm going, okay, look like, ain't no parking over here. It's going to be a bitch. All right, look, just keep riding with us. We know where to go. Georgetown never failed me growing up. I'm like, okay, we definitely going to be able to find parking and we're going to be able to find some food in Georgetown. So we drove about an extra maybe 25 to 30 minutes just to go into Georgetown. Again, traffic, Friday night. Congested, because any other time, man, you'd be there in half the time. Mm-hmm. You would be there in half the time. Believe me. Okay. So we finally get to Georgetown. We're in Georgetown, like, probably like maybe around 10:30-ish or some shit like that. And yeah, at this point, I've already told Jeremy and them up at the website, I'm going, look, like, I'm entertaining some out of town guests. We got out pretty late. I know I said I was, but there's just, Lee, don't trip. It's all good, man. We understand. Just have fun. Enjoy Awesome Con weekend and all that. It's all good. I'm like, okay, cool. So we go to Georgetown and I'm like, yo, there should be a parking joint right around here. I'm like, let me just think for a second, try to remember the layout here. I'm telling Tams, I'm like, okay, don't listen to the navigator. Like, you want to go here.
yeah, but I'm trying to, like, I'm telling you, like, I know this area. You want to go here? Like, okay. So we make this turn, we make that turn. Like, okay, there should be parking over there. Shops at Georgetown. Parking's going to be on your right. So you're going to need to turn right. Sure enough, still there. Like, yes. So we find parking. Then we come up. We're actually parked right next to each other. So that was great. There was plenty of parking over there. So that was great. I'm like, yo, welcome to Georgetown, right? I had texted him. I'm like, welcome to Georgetown. And his brother was just text, food. And I'm like, okay. I'm like, it's coming. All right. So then we get done parking. We come out. And I told Mish right then and there, I said, the way that we should have done this, we should have left our cars and taken an Uber into Adams Morgan, get our eat on, all that shit, and then take an Uber coming back. Mm-hmm. Like, that's how we should have done it. That's how we should have done it. He liked that idea and was like, yeah. And I get where, because there was an issue about for them, not for us, but for them, because of where they parked, they were only going to have access to their vehicle until a certain time. Mm-hmm. Whereas where we parked,
we could have been there all night.
Right. And we have before, to the point I want to recommend for anybody that's going to be doing stuff in Northwest DC, whether you're going to be doing something around the Gallery Place Chinatown area, something near the Washington Convention Center, you're just going to be in that general vicinity. If you need a good place to park, and you don't have to worry about, oh man, I'm gonna come here the next day, but my vehicle is gonna be gone. You don't wanna worry about stupid shit like that. And reasonable rates, I highly would encourage you to check out the City Place Garage that is in Northwest Washington. Great prices, and you can leave your vehicle there for a couple of days. You just gotta make sure you have your ticket. And when it's all said and done, you'll just get one flat out, good solid price, and that's it. Each time that we've done Awesome Con, that's where we've stayed. And I thought for sure that was the address that I gave to Mish, but he ended up going somewhere else. And the best part I like about them, you can access your vehicle at any time 24/7. You can leave anytime 24/7, unlike some of the parking lots that they got set up around there. Right,
they close off.
So we come up from the shops and I'm showing them, hey, that used to be a sex store. Hey, that used to be, right, all this cool shit. And like, where you guys want to go eat? I'm like, you guys want to go in this direction, basically the direction of the exorcism stairs, the infamous exorcism stairs. Or, okay, do you guys want to maybe go up this way? Almost kind of like you're going up towards Foggy Bottom Metro Station, you know, Upper Pennsylvania Avenue. Like, you guys want to go in that direction? Like, let's go towards Foggy Bottom. Like, okay, cool. So we're still in the heart of Georgetown. So we walk. Anybody that knows about that one joint, when I say you're in the heart of Georgetown, that joint that used to be a bank, I don't know if it's still a bank, but it's got the big gold dome that's on top of it. Y'all know exactly what I'm talking about. So we pretty much went across the street and we had got it down to two restaurants. We had got it down to the Bodega Spanish Tapas and Lounge. And then around the corner from that, there was a couple of upscale pizzeria joints.
Italian food.
Wasn't there like some type of a wine violin restaurant?
Yeah, that was an Italian restaurant.
That was an Italian restaurant. Mm-hmm. Okay. So.
So pizza was like, yeah, no. You know, when you're from Chicago and then you come to East Coast pizza, it's nowhere near the same. As Lee can certainly tell you, in reference to that, but they were like, yeah, no, I don't think I want to have the comparison, meal here, you know? So we ended up going to the Bodega, great service, good food.
Yeah.
And everybody seemed to enjoy themselves.
Except for me, I didn't like my fucking appetizer meal. I mean, these motherfuckers were basically eating mashed potatoes, green beans, and fucking chicken. All of it looked fucking immaculate. I'm looking at my joint. I'm like, I'm going to get the lambs. Yeah, the lambs sound good. Let me get the lamb pork chops. These motherfuckers give me lamb pork chops that are maybe half the size of a mechanical pencil. And as far as the width goes, as far as like how much meat is on these bones, it's about two mechanical pencils combined width-wise. And I was done in 60 seconds. I bullshit you not. I was done eating the shit. Yeah, and I remember missing them. Somebody better eat this last roll of bread. Somebody better. And I'm like, good. You're going to get the main entree. Like, we don't need that. Man, I see my shit. I go out loud. Yeah, I guess I do need the bread. Because it's like, where's the meat, right? Remember the old lady?
Where's the rest of my entree?
Right. Remember the old lady from the Wendy's commercials back in the day? Where's the beef? Right? Like, in this case, where's the meat? Like, because there's literally no meat on these fucking bones. And they gave me like half a scoop of fucking mashed potatoes with a tiny little bit of gravy. You know, put a couple of fucking plants on it, little flower lamps. Flower little leaves or whatever, and basically call that shit a meal. Like, what the fuck? So I was greatly disappointed. Tastes good, but I was greatly disappointed. Next thing you know, the funny part though was when the bill came. That was the funny part. So the funny part.
Don't give it all away? Nope.
When you say don't give it all away, like tell the story, but leave some very important details out, or tell the story but avoid the bookend.
Tell the story, but leave very important details out.
Leave very important details out. Okay, so let's try this. So we get the bill, and I say to Mission, don't worry about it. And Mission's like, you sure, bud? Like, yeah, don't worry about it. You're a guest. You're a guest. Don't worry about it. His brother, I'll tell it straight up. His brother was kind of fucking it up because his brother is like, well, how much is it? Anyway, I'm looking at it and I'm smiling. I'm like, don't worry about it, right? Because it's kind of like, when they say don't worry about it, don't worry about it. And so his brother is like, well, I know drinks was, and
he
I
was
know,
trying to calculate it in his head.
And I know my plate was, and Mrs. plate was, and I know for my drinks it was. And I'm just looking up, nodding my head, I'm just looking at him, and I'm smiling, I'm just going, don't worry about it. And I'm thinking to myself, don't fuck it up, dude. If somebody says they're going to fucking cover it, don't fucking worry about it, right? And so Mish is like me. If a motherfucker says twice they got it, they ain't going for no third. They shutting the fuck up. I don't know if that's a Chicago thing or just, I don't know what that is. But like, when a motherfucker says, you sure? Like, yeah. You sure you got it? Like, yeah. Okay. That's it. You say a third time? Oh, well, if you insist. It's like, if you insist, right? But I'm looking at his brother and I'm thinking to myself, dude, you gonna fuck it up now. Right? You gonna fuck it up? Nope. Zip it. You don't fuck it up now. And So they let it go. I wouldn't be surprised if Mish had stomped on his foot under the tape.
I wouldn't either, actually.
I wouldn't be surprised. So, right, you know, so, but no, because like my whole thing was, and it wasn't a guilt trip or anything. Not at all. No, that's Mish is my boy. My whole thing was, yo, these are our guests. And, you know, we want to show them the best hospitality that's humanly possible, especially keeping in mind my man just did all this fucking driving.
Yep. And all that expense that they incurred just coming out to do it. So that was the least that we could do.
Right. You know what I'm saying? So it was like, no, we got this, right? It was like, you know, trying to show you the best sights, sounds in D.C., all that good stuff and everything. And so the night pretty much ended. We all went right next door to the Haagen-Dazs store. And we were, you know, me and Tams got ice cream. I think they got like some type of shake drinks or whatever. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that was dessert, obviously.
That was my dinner.
And that was Lee's dinner.
Because I didn't get full, not by a long shot.
And mind you, we both had honestly been on, which we still are, you know, just trying to eat healthier and that aspect. And basically, yeah, I mean, we were right on point with that bodega in reference to our having our... not cheat meal, but it wasn't essentially a cheat meal because we both got on the scale a couple of days later and it was like,
The next day.
The next day, I was like, oh, hey, that wasn't too bad.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, the meal taste of what I had was really good and very fresh. So it was good. And it was just the amount of right amount of proportions, you know, for everything. And it was good.
So I do recommend them, you know, especially if you're just doing it for a special occasion.
Yeah, special occasion, and make sure that you're asking about the portions of each thing, depending on what you have a taste for.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, the other thing that was funny. So we get the menus and what's in it is in English. But the name of them is in Spanish. And I know poquito in reference to Spanish. So I'm just like, I can't read none of this. So it was kind of funny part.
I tell you, that whole weekend was just, it was fun. Because it was the best, it's the best fun we had in a long time. And that pretty much was setting us up for our wedding anniversary weekend. And I just was going, man, so we had all this go down Friday night. What's the rest of our time off gonna entail and everything? So we went into the rest of Awesome Con weekend. We pretty much put a nice pretty little ribbon around that. Again, you guys by now, you know about the footage that's out there for it. So check it out when you guys get a chance. If you haven't already, you know, show it a lot of love, spread it around, all that good stuff. And so after we get done with Awesome Con weekend, then it pretty much was, okay, so what are we doing now? What are we going to set ourselves up for? You know, what's the game plan? And originally, and it was actually kind of nice before the weekend was out for AwesomeCon. I showed Tammy just a few of my DC stomping grounds. So that was nice to show her and everything, because I didn't get a chance to do it the previous years. I mean, She saw little bits of, hey, I used to kind of hang out right here, or hey, I kind of used to frequent this, but she didn't get a chance to really see stomping grounds like that. So it was nice over that respective weekend to be able to show her some of my hangout spots and everything, and my how the neighborhood changed drastically. For example, we went through Thomas Circle, and I was showing her how, hey, there used to be a Popeyes that was right here, and you know, my best friend who was in high school, she used to, you know, work here, and I lived right around the corner from her when she was working at the Popeyes. I lived right around the corner, and I showed her where I had lived from around the corner, and was telling her the fun stories about it. There also used to be this convenience store that was just about right next door to the Popeyes that I would always frequent, because my mom would usually want a pack of cigarettes and some booze, and I would usually be able to get it from that convenience store, load up on some snacks as well, all of that. Or sometimes I would go to the 24/7 CVS that was right across the street. I can't remember what the name of the hotel was at that point in time, but there was a Planet Fitness that was behind this hotel that I would go to from time to time and everything. So it was nice showing her old stomping grounds like that. But then it was, okay, so what are we going to do? How are we going to spend our, you know, week plus vacation? What are we going to do? One of the original plans that we had in mind was, well, let's go up to PA. Let's see the Rocky statue. Maybe we could go get some White Castle. But then when we're looking up the most recent reviews, I don't know how you guys roll, but when it comes to me, I like getting a really good gauge on what to expect, and as close to real time that I can have people's experiences, the better. And I'm seeing the latest rounds of reviews for, hopefully I say reviews and not interviews, because I kind of feel as though, I did say reviews. Okay, great. So I'm looking at the latest round of reviews for the Rocky statue and all that. And basically it's in front of a museum. And you guys probably heard that shriek. That's our puppy Chloe that's being a badass right now. So anyway, so we see the most recent reviews for the Rocky statue, and motherfuckers are basically saying, yo, the wait time for this, it's anywhere between 30 minutes. You're averaging almost an hour just to be able to go see the Rocky statue. Like, damn, right? And it's almost the same thing for going up the steps, the infamous Rocky steps, going up to the top and taking the picture of the, you know, beautiful city and all of that. So we're going, okay. And then we're really marinating on it. We're going, okay, do we really want to drive about over 3 hours just to do that? And then turn right back around and go home? Like, and see, this goes back to Chloe. Chloe is very clingy still. She was born November of last year. And she is still, I've had a few pets in my time, but she is the most clingiest dog that I've ever come across, because she's got to have access to one of us. She is not a fan when one of us leaves the bedroom or leaves the room. She is most content and calm when both of us are together. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's much worse when Tams is not here, because I got to hear about it for at least the first 30 minutes. And then she kind of, you know, calms herself down, and it, you know, it is what it is. And that's it, right? Until she sees mommy again. But right down to the point, I said to Tams, I said, yo, ask your moms, what is she noticing whenever we're not here? Because she pretty much has access to the girls, you know, when we're doing our thing or whatever, right? When we're traveling, all that stuff. And we got word, you know, from, you know, when she, you know, does volunteer to, you know, house sit for us and all that, and, you know, check on the pets and all that, from the information we got with her, from her, it was, yeah, you know, she is barking pretty much either nonstop. She's making noises nonstop. It's very seldom that she's quiet. She either stops for a little bit or she's pretty much nonstop, and she's mostly nonstop. So keeping that in mind, you're going, well, shit, if we're trying to travel and we go to a hotel that does accept pets, well, we don't know what's going on with our I guess, neighbors.
Right.
At that hotel. Mm-hmm. You know, we don't know what's going on with those other hotel guests that are around us, and what type of a schedule they're on. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe they're trying to sleep during the day because they got something they've got to do that's important at night, or right. We don't know what's
going on. But not only that, who wants to hear a dog yapping for an hour straight?
Or a couple of hours straight, the way your mom was saying it.
You know,
yeah.
So it's kind of like, okay, so being protective of the other persons that we would be around in reference to, you know, not making their stay miserable, mm-hmm. You know, you kind of go, okay, well, you know, what are you going to do? Mm-hmm. And that's, so we decided just to kind of hang out, you know, and see what was in the area.
Yeah.
You know? So, bummer for us, to a point, in reference to, you know, what we could do. But for the most part, you know, I was all right.
Yeah, yeah. You know, so, but we were bummed about that, because I definitely was looking forward to seeing the Rocky statue. Then we was like, okay, well, what about Hershey, PA? And the more and more we thought about it, it was a case where, you know what, if we're going to do something like that, we really want to just stay the night, really be able to enjoy the sights and sounds. Mm-hmm. And we're really cheating ourselves to just go all the way up there, do that, grab some fucking White Castle or whatever, and then drive back. It's like, that's a disservice to us. Like, nah. So we're already talking about doing a trip to PA at, you know, sometime in the next couple of months and do all of that nice, lovely stuff. And, mm-hmm. you know, we'll definitely have a dog sitter in mind already, because when we were doing our thing Friday for AwesomeCon, Tam's dad had came up and stayed with the girls for a couple of hours. And from what I was able to see, everything had went pretty well. He said that they didn't give him a hard time, particularly Chloe did not give him a hard time. We already know Maggie's cool, but Maggie has gotten to a point now where it's pretty much monkey see, monkey do when it comes to Chloe. If Chloe is barking,
and Maggie's barking. Yep.
If Chloe is, I'm trying to get some food, and Maggie follows suits, and, you know, she's nice trying to. Person. Right. You know, so I won't say jealousy. You could tell Maggie was jealous. Now it's just kind of, go ahead. Do that shit so we can, We can eat. That's how I see Maggie is pretty much rolling now, you know, these days.
No, I know what it is. Chloe's Paul Heyman.
Yeah. My client and I would like to trouble you for something to eat, if you don't mind. We really could use a treat.
Yep, that's fine.
Yeah,
that's Chloe.
So then we were gonna go up to the MGM casino, because we had heard so much about it. I remember when I was working for my first market research company, I remember I did studies in the area all the time on casinos, right down to the point I was doing studies before the MGM casino at the harbor was even built. And I was engaging people in a focus group study about how would they feel about a casino basically being right here, even more centered locally in the DMV area and everything, engaging people on that. And so I'm like, yeah, you know, maybe we should try the MGM casino. Look up the real-time reviews for it, and man, everybody was having bad experience after bad experience after bad experience. Shout out to my boy Steven, though. Steven, he's somebody I've mentioned from time to time. He also does some work over there at 401 Mania. He had, you know, hit me up in a private message, and he was like, yo, my man, you should have told me you were gonna, hey, look this person up. I think he still works there. Tell him I said hi. He gonna take good care of you. I'm like, cool. Mm. And, you know, and I was nice about it. I said, we had a change of plans. I didn't want to tell him the truth and say, yo, I was reading the recent reviews. And yeah, no. And like some of the recent reviews that really turned me off, and I'm sure it probably turned some of you guys off as well. It came down to the customer service. I mean, this was recent. Everybody was talking about how the customer service, they made you feel stupid. They berated you, they belittled you, they didn't make you feel as though your time, but most importantly, your money
was valued
there. Mm-hmm. And this was coming from people that have traveled all around the world in the United mm-hmm. States, frequenting
MGMs,
yeah, mm-hmm. frequenting casinos. And they were like, yo, this is the worst one. Mm-hmm. The fact that, yo, there's no complimentary drink, not alcohol, but just, you know, hey, no soda, yeah. no water.
No free plays.
It was like, whoa, mm-hmm. well, that kind of, and I was telling Tams, I said, yo, this would be my first real experience gambling. And I want it to really count. And I'm going, nah, if these reviews are like this, and this is like days old, yeah, I'm not really feeling this, dog. Like, we got to do something that to, which mm-hmm. to Tam's point, she said, well, not for nothing, but I heard Maryland Live is 3 times better, to the point some of the focus group studies that I used to do, man, we used to stay getting from the respondents' answers, love them some Maryland Live. Mm-hmm. So if it wasn't Maryland Live, they also love
Charleston.
Was that Charleston? West Virginia. Yeah, mm-hmm. they had loved that one. So it was like, okay, all right, bump that. But we did go see the National Harbor. And that was actually my first time that I'm aware of, mm-hmm. unless it all wasn't there. But that was my first time being at the harbor. And that was nice. You know, beautiful sights, sounds, great people. But here's where it gets very interesting. So we ate at this great place called Cadillac Ranch. And it's definitely a place, Mish and Julian, they already know, but it's definitely a place I'm making sure I take them to. And it's definitely a place I highly recommend to you guys that's looking for some excellent barbecue. Barbecue chicken alert. Barbecue chicken alert. Barbecue chicken alert, Ernie. Barbecue chicken alert. Delicious barbecue ribs. Delicious barbecue chicken. That food was fucking bomb. Coleslaw was excellent. I'm very particular about my coleslaw because I've had coleslaw that tastes soggy and runny. I've had coleslaw that was very watery. I've had coleslaw that wasn't fresh. It tasted as if, yo, this is like 3, 4, 5 days old. What the fuck are you giving me here? I can tell this is about to go sour. What the fuck? This coleslaw was fresh. Everything that was holding it together was not too thick. It was just right. Mm-hmm. Fucking loved it. They hit a home run with that. The meat off of the ribs, it was tender, was not chewy whatsoever. I loved how it just easily, with a knife and fork, how it easily just came off.
Mm-hmm.
I love, same thing for the chicken, nice and moist.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just everything, banging. The fries, the way they hook you up with the fries, that's part of this main entree, way they hook you up with it, they give you a combination. They give you waffle fries.
Wedges.
Wedges.
And this.
Straight cut fries. Straight cut. Mm-hmm. Nice little fucking combination that they give you. So I thought that was pretty badass.
And it wasn't overcooked at all. I mean, nah. It was seasoned just right.
Yeah.
It was just right in reference to how they fried it.
Yeah.
It was great.
And speaking of how they fried it, you can tell when somebody is using old grease to fry up something. Not the case whatsoever. No, to the point, the place that we ate at a day or two prior, which was
our local AMC.
Oh my God, we didn't even talk about Top Gun Maverick yet. We'll get to that in a hot second. So, but to my point, in regards to the food that we ate at the AMC, you know, I was sick afterwards. I went almost a whole day after eating the food there at AMC. I went a whole day needing to basically reset my stomach because, you know, the only time my stomach will get like that is if, okay, you've either eaten too much fried food and or the grease that was used was pretty beat up as it was. And right, that's the only time I will get usually that sick, that I'll have that much of an upset stomach. But here at Cadillac Ranch, oh, everything was fresh. Everything was fresh. The grease they used, definitely fresh. You taste the raw food itself. It was fucking badass. We had shared a big-ass pretzel, salted pretzel, that came with a cup of nacho cheese and a cup of honey mustard. But the honey mustard had a whole lot of
horseradish.
Yeah, it was just,
and look, it was overkill.
Look, if you're trying to clear up your sinuses,
it's perfect.
Perfect, fucking perfect. But that was fucking overkill. That was fucking overkill. So we did good there because we had got a loaded nacho chili cheese tater tot joint. For an appetizer.
Which is like a different version of like a nacho cheese and chips.
Yeah. Just with tater tots and right. they drench it with chili cheese.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking badass. So we got all of that.
Plus two beers and two sodas.
I tried something new. I tried Dos Equis. Actually, it was pretty good. No buzz whatsoever. Tastes great. Went down great, but no buzz whatsoever. So for me, you know, I give you a 5 for effort.
I give it a 10, no buzz.
You know, see, here's the thing. Here's the thing. And Tams is really kind of, her dad really put a bad impression on people that drank on her because he would act like a dick. With me, I'm the type of person, when I drink, I can be quiet, but I can be very funny as well. I'll want to crack jokes. I'll want to do, you know, depending on how much proof is in whatever beverage that you're giving me. The worst thing that'll happen, I will just do some stupid, funny shit.
Corny.
And it could be corny as well.
Mm-hmm.
But that's it. That's the worst thing that can happen. I'm a fun drunk, right? Not that I drink to get drunk. I drink because I want to relax. I want to feel as loose as possible. I want to feel relaxed. I want to feel good. I want to feel a little giddy. And sometimes I can get that with certain beverages. And for me, when I don't get that with certain beverages, and in this case, Dos Equis, it becomes, okay, well, you know what? You're not worth whatever price tag that you're being given, because if I just basically want some bubbly water, then just give me some sparkling water. And that's to my point. That's exactly what the Dos Equis taste like, right? Like, okay, that's great. You got that nice kind of bubbly seltzer type of, but you're not delivering on the proof. Right. And I'm not saying, yo, you got to load that son of a bitch up with 90% proof. But anytime I can get a buzz off of a dogfish head, and I can't get nothing off of one Dos Equis, that's a problem. To the point when I got the second Dos Equis, I thought for sure, okay, I'll get a buzz. Nothing. Nothing whatsoever. And it was just, okay, that was a waste of money. That's not cool. All right. That's not cool. So for me, you know, you really want to get on my good side, you know, get me a good beer that's got, you know, some decent proof. Get me a beer that, you know, has the flavor, but I'm definitely paying attention to that proof. Like for me, I've gotten the buzz off of a beer that had 7% alcohol and up. That Dos Equis, I would be shocked to hear if, well, not for nothing, Lee, but it actually has 5% alcohol or 6% alcohol. Because my whole thing would be, well, I never felt it. And it's rare I drink. It's rare I drink. Like, I would be shocked to hear that thing had any alcohol at all, to my point. I wouldn't be surprised if a motherfucker said to me, it was only 3% alcohol, or it was only 4% alcohol, because I felt nothing whatsoever. But no, I'm a happy drinker when I drink. I'm just very low key, you know. Yeah, my jokes are corny. You know, I would rather be, and that's how I have always been. I have always been that way. I've always been that type of a drinker. I would rather be that than somebody that is very mean-spirited, gets physical, you know, does stupid shit, and then they wake up the next day in a fucking jail cell. No thanks. No thanks. But, yes, we got all of that for $70. You know, we didn't even need to get another main entree. I mean, the portions were all hearty right across the board, even for the appetizers. Everything was banging.
Yeah. To the point, we actually took a substantial doggy back home.
Yeah. Yeah. So it was great. So I do recommend that. We're definitely looking forward to going again, because it turns out they've got the food is great, one. And then two, there's a mechanical bull. So I definitely want to ride that bad boy next time. See how long I can last on that. But the strangest thing happened while we were at Cadillac Ranch. So we're engaged in a conversation and, you know, we're kicking back. We're watching some NCAA track racing that's going on one set, and baseball game on the other. But we were really just watching the women that were on that were racing there on the track and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And next thing you know, these girls start breaking out into a happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. And I'm going, why does that sound fucking familiar? I'm going, man, it's pitch perfect. the harmonies, everything is just, why does this sound familiar? And I'm looking at Tams and we're looking at each other and I'm just kind of shaking my head and we're just going back to our conversation. But it stayed with me all fucking day because I'm going, why does this sound familiar? So it didn't dawn on me until Sunday morning.
Early
Sunday morning. I'm watching fucking the NBA Finals. So I'm watching game 2, 3, and 4. I already watched one. So I know one was a blowout, right? So I'm catching up on 2, 3, and 4. By this time, it's about 4 in the morning. And I do like the Leonardo DiCaprio meme where he's pointing at the TV like that right there, right? That fucking meme. And then it dawns on me, yo, those were the motherfuckers that were from the fucking Odyssey cruise ship that we took in DC a year ago. Exactly a year ago. So let me set up the Odyssey in a nutshell without it being a long-winded story. So the Odyssey, when we got married last year, after we came back from North Carolina, we stayed home for a couple of days, catching up on rest, straightening up around the house, setting a few little gifts that we got, kind of setting those up and everything. And then we had decided in those couple of days that we were home and recharging, resetting, okay, look, let's go hang out in Alexandria. And there was like this great hotel that was over there, very friendly towards pets, some nice, cool places to go eat. And then we came up with the idea of, hey, well, let's go ride a spirited cruise. And basically a spirited cruise, in this case, the Odyssey, you basically would, go to the point of, okay, you need to be here because the boat's going to leave at this time. And basically you would stay on this boat for about 90 minutes, maybe 2 hours tops. And it would basically take you across DC, pretty much go into Virginia, and then it would pretty much make a U-turn back. And in the process of all of that, you would eat some really good food that was there, enjoy the company of your party, and who knows, maybe you might make a new friend in the process, who knows, right? So we're on this ship, and it was really hard for us. There was another couple, to the point, us and this other couple, we kind of made eye contact with each other, kind of like, Jesus, what the fuck? Because there was this one party that was like 15 motherfuckers deep, okay? Mm-hmm. 15 motherfuckers deep.
And they were wearing all white.
And they were wearing all white. That was their trademark. They were wearing all white. And we're going, okay. And the next thing you know, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. I'm going, right? And so it kind of ruined the whole experience because they were just, it felt like they were making it all about them. And, but I'm not trying to sound like a dick. I'm just going to throw it out there. But it felt like they were trying to make it like, this is our cruise. This is our ship, right? It's all about us. And it's like, yeah, but there's other people that's on here.
You wouldn't know it.
You wouldn't, right.
You wouldn't know it with that party that there was other people on the ship.
Right.
They were pretty much there.
Yes.
And that was their boat.
And that was their boat. Look at me. Look at me. Look at me. I am the captain now. Right. It's kind of one of those type of deals.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I just remember how much of a bad impression it had left with me. And I was pretty positive that one of the girls had read my review of what I had said, because she didn't take any shade or diss at us, but she tried to justify, I think she was trying to justify probably what I said in my review about the obnoxious crowd that were there. One of them was saying, oh, it was there because it was my birthday and all that, right? And so I'm going, whatever. So we're at the bar for Cadillac Ranch. Happy birthday. 4 in the morning, these motherfuckers were on the Odyssey. And I said that shit out loud. And I go, babe. She's, Tams is knocked out. I'm like, babe. I'm like, the motherfuckers. Cadillac Ranch. And the same niggas that was on the fucking cruise.
But first he was like, what day was the cruise?
Right.
And so he's looking.
Yeah.
And lo and behold, it was the very same day of the cruise.
Date exactly to the year.
Probably the same time, too.
Probably the same time. Well, hell.
Uh-huh.
Hell, you think about what time,
uh-huh.
right? It matches up.
Uh-huh.
It matches up. And then when I play back in my head, I was noticing certain groups of Black people walking around the harbor and all that. I was noticing themed colors. And I'm going, and it didn't click. That should have been my first sign there.
True.
Because that's what they did on the Odyssey joint.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't click in my head. And then once I started piecing everything together, I kind of felt like Dude in the Usual Suspects movie. And he was just piecing everything together. And he realizes it's fucking Kevin Spacey. Well, the retard. Where's the retard? Where'd the retard go? Right? And he realized, oh shit, Kevin Spacey was faking it the whole time. Right? I piece it all together and it's like, son of a bitch, that was them. That was fucking them. And so, yeah, I said to Tampa, say, yo, going forward, we just need to dodge June 11th altogether. But at the same time, apparently DC and the
National Harbor.
Yeah.
Which isn't very far from each other.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. But they got good taste. I'll give them that. They got good taste. Shit, they did the Odyssey last year and now they're doing Cadillac Ranch. They got some good ass fucking taste.
I agree.
It was funny, man. It was crazy. So let's see. Anything else had went down since? I'm trying to think. Feels like I'm missing something that's in there.
We were gonna go to the African American Museum in DC.
Yeah, yeah.
That was one of our thought process. You know, one of the thoughts that we were gonna do, but unfortunately, anybody who's in the DC area. You can't just get tickets the day of anymore, even at this point.
Yeah.
They are released once in the beginning of the month for that month, and that's when you get your tickets.
Yeah.
Anything else, you can show up there, and it's hit or miss whether or not you can get in.
Right.
But so it's kind of like, okay, so do we try that and go and see? And I was like, no. So we ended up passing in reference to, you know, the maybe we do, maybe we don't. You know, we possibly thought about going to the monument. You know, I've been there once. And it was okay. I mean, you know, it was good for what it was.
You got to tell them. I'm a kick back and I'm just going to mellow out. You got to tell them the story about Silver Diner.
Lord have mercy. Okay. So anyway, with the monument, we decided not on that, but we did end up having an awesome experience, except for the food, and seeing a Maverick, but we will get into that in just a minute. Now, getting to Silver Diner. Okay, so let me set this up for you guys. There has been a weekend of nothing but Awesome Con. Okay. Awesome Con is 2 days before my 1 year anniversary. Babe, can we pull it off? Oh yeah, I think we can, but we just don't do Sunday. Okay, fair enough. So we get through Friday, we get through Saturday, so on and so forth. I'm like, okay, cool. Sunday, let's go, right? So Sunday morning turns into Sunday mid-morning, and then it's Sunday afternoon, and it's either sleep or some kind of editing for the show. I'm like, okay, thinking to myself, all right, this is a wonderful way to start our anniversary. So finally, we get to the point where we can go ahead. We're leaving the girls at the house. You know, we go ahead, we go out. And there was a couple of different places I started to pick for us. And I thought, well, Silver Diner's decent. It's a newer spot down there. And yeah, okay. And the funny thing is, it was between, one was Copper Canyon, and they're kind of a nationwide chain, so I don't know if you know them or not, but it's a decent place. We actually went there maybe about 5 years ago for my birthday, and had a really good meal. And I thought, okay.
Not 5 years ago, ten years ago.
Oh, okay. Yeah. 10 years ago.
We went there during our first. Pretty much our first year. We went there on your first birthday that we were a couple, that we were pretty much steady.
Okay.
Yeah.
So probably sort of year number two.
You're correct.
So anyway, and so it was a combination toss up between that. I'm like, okay. So I said, yeah, let's do Silver Dinah. Lee was like, yeah, let's just go ahead and eat in. Yeah, sure. Good ambiance. So on and so forth. Wonderful. So we get our drinks. The hostess was wonderful. In reference to, she was a sweetheart. She got our drinks. So on and so forth. Everything was cool. I even asked for a specialty drink. Most people, I don't really drink that way. So with that being said, I ordered a specialty drink and they're making some accommodations. And that was cool. So we ordered. And we ordered an entree. We ordered two entrees and an appetizer. We wait. And we wait. And we wait. And we wait some more. And nothing's coming. And neither is the waitress at this point. The heck? I mean, I know it's a little busy, but it's not crazy. Okay. So I'm like, yeah. And honestly, mind you, now I'm starting to get a little chilled. Okay, great. All right. So finally, they come. First of all, our waitress comes, mind you, nowhere to be seen when the food comes out. And I'm like, okay. Interesting. So then I'm like, well, all right, let's dig in. So we get the entree the two entrees and the appetizer all together. I'm like, well, that's kind of defeats the purpose, but all right. Then somewhere about 5-10 minutes, I assume, our waitress comes. Hey, everything okay? Well, at that point, we had just been barely digging into the food. Yeah, everything's fine. Go away. Not what I said, but it's kind of like, yeah, you know, you left us hanging for 15-20 minutes, you know, and then you show up now. So as we're digging in, I'm like, well, the fries ain't too bad. Kind of chilled, but they're not too bad. And I tried part of the appetizer, which actually was the best part of the meal, which was, I think, was like catfish fingers or something, which was decent. And we had one of our entrees was impossible meatballs and cauliflower mac.
Correct.
Yeah. So that was one of them. Then I had fries and a chicken sandwich, which I think they put like 4 chicken tenders and a half on my sandwich, which didn't taste like anything. Really, it didn't taste flavorful. It didn't taste anything. Fries were getting cold. And the other entree, I'm sorry, but I have had impossible stuff in the last year. And I've had cauliflower themed pasta stuff as well. And that was the absolute most awful meal I have tasted in a very, very long time. So between mine that was cold, actually they were both cold when we got them, and the fact that they didn't taste like anything, besides, of course, the appetizer was okay. So in the meantime, we're trying to digest this lovely, lovely meal, ha ha ha, and we're getting the eyes like, y'all not gonna eat any more of that? What's wrong with it? And so then they come up to the table and it's like, oh, would you guys like a doggy bag? I mean, all this, you know, really, you know, oh, would you guys like a doggy bag? And we're like, no. And then there was this 30-second pause of awkward looks and silence. Like, really? You don't want a doggy bag? No. You know, the point where you're like, yeah, the food fucking sucks and we're just ready for the bill so we can pay it and get the fuck out of here. But no, we're good. Pretty much sums it up, right? All right. So we pay the bill, which, mind you, for the food we had really not liked, to the point where we were just talking about the beer that didn't give you a buzz. He didn't even finish the first half of the beer he had with that meal. So,
yeah, this was only one beer I had purchased, too. As a matter of fact, I'm looking at the beer. So, I mean, I like trying new beers when I get an opportunity, but this beer, you know, it's bad. You know, I'm pretty pissed off when I don't finish my beer. I had got a Estrella beer, Estrella Dom. Barcelona, 1976. That's what I had got. And I couldn't even... Actually, you know what? No, that was at the bodega. Hang on. That was at the bodega. And that was actually pretty good. That was actually good beer.
Wrong spot.
The one I am thinking of is... Hang on a second. Keep talking. I'll find it.
So, mind you, this particular meal came to almost $60.
Loose Cannon IPA.
Okay. And almost $60, and I'm like, okay. So I'm thinking to myself, do I really want to pay for this? Yeah, I don't want to have to fight with anybody. You know, I just won't, for this one, I just won't come back. That's just it. We finally go, you know, and get out, pay the bill, whatever have you. And then there proceeds to be a very interesting Google review, which was necessary. They offered us to talk and they offered, you know, a free entree. And I'm thinking, how are you going to give us a free entree for food that already sucks? So, no, I'm really good. I don't think I want to go through that torture again. To the point where I'd actually texted my best friend and said, hey, they're giving us two free entrees. Would you like it? She said, well, which usually most people jump on free, right? And she said, well, the last time I was there, they burnt my pancakes pretty bad. And I think I'm good.
Right.
So obviously, you know, besides our experience, and you can't even give free entrees away. I mean, it's free.
Right.
So, needless to say, we cut our losses and did a nice little stroll in the area, which has a nice little, you know, walkway around a pond. And that, you know, was a nice night in reference to the walk and what have you. But I was just like, at that point, I was just like so over the day. It's like, and of course, at that point, I had to actually work the next day. So I couldn't even enjoy the remainder of my actual 1 year anniversary. I had a funky day that included not being with my significant other, damn near it. I got a crappy ass meal and a nice walk and some cute little pictures. Okay, well, I'll give you that. And Lee was so ticked off that he came home, went to the room, and started watching basketball. And then I was like, we can't even watch a show? He's like, nope, I'm trying to forget about the meal.
Yeah.
So needless to say, we spent a couple days of this coming week or the week that would just pass trying to erase the memory of our first anniversary, which I don't know that that'll happen, but we had some good meals and some good fun.
And the irony of this, when it's all said and done.
Oh, yeah. I told you about that story. Yep.
Yeah, mention that.
So let's kind of go back. I think I was on the way home. I said, boy, we're two for two. And he's like, what do you mean? I was making crappy meals. He's like, huh? I was like, yeah. So once we came back after the wedding, we came back to the condo and had, you know, cake and champagne and stuff for the guests. Didn't really have any other hors d'oeuvres or whatever because most people had already eaten. So, but we hadn't because we were pretty much getting ready for the wedding and all that entails, right? So we go out after we had both changed out of our attire and we actually went out and we're going to take my mom and the two of us, we're going to go and get something to eat. Well, mind you, this is Atlantic Beach. If anybody but anybody knows about Atlantic Beach, the only thing that Atlantic Beach has is a little bit of something, but mainly a whole lot of nothing. And after 8 o'clock, that little bit of something turns into a whole lot of nothing. So we go into this one place that's open and we go and we're like, yeah, and it's a bar. I'm thinking, yeah, this isn't the atmosphere I want for that to be my dinner after my wedding. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and especially, you know, my mom, his, you know, mother-in-law, all that, right? So we go and turn around. We take my mom back to her hotel, and then we go back to the condo. And what we had was bologna sandwiches and chips. But at least on the better note is the fact that it actually tasted a heck of a lot better than the meal that we had last week.
Right.
So in that force coming full circle, it's two for two, right?
Right.
So there you go. There you have it. You just can't win on that one.
Nah. But we kind of redeemed ourselves a little bit when it came to Top Gun Maverick. And I was mentioning it to the guy at the comic book store that I frequent on a weekly basis. And he was like, yo, don't spoil it for me. I'm getting ready to go see it. Don't spoil it for me. And I told him, I said, you're really, really going to enjoy it. Like, you know how crazy Tom Cruise is when it comes to doing his own stunts and shit. But visually, it's breathtaking. And he was telling me, well, I actually have a friend that was in Top Gun. Not the movie, but he actually, you know, in real life
was in the
Top Gun classes. And he was talking about how authentic, how accurate it is, what they have going on with the planes, the jets, you know, doing their flying and the simulation of the fighting and all of that. And I can't stress it enough. If you guys did not get a chance to see Top Gun Maverick yet, you owe it to yourselves to go and see it. You'll thank us later. If you are a fan at all at any time of the original and you were a bit on the fence about, man, I just don't really know if this is really going to deliver to what I remember from, what was it, 86? 86 is Top Gun. I don't know if this is really going to live up to it or if it's going to tarnish the legacy. Those fears, put them to rest. Put them to rest because Tom Cruise and crew, they did a phenomenal job. And, you know, if you didn't really stay on top of news related to this sequel, take comfort knowing that Tom Cruise had spent decades entertained with the idea of doing a sequel. He just was in a position where how he was envisioning it, technology didn't quite catch up. And so he patiently was waiting for it to go down and it finally everything aligned. And I know one thing that has a lot of people that have seen Top Gun Maverick or are fans of the franchise, they hear how everybody's tripping over the fact that, oh, the chick from the first movie, she's not in this. What's going on? And then when you find out basically, okay, well, not only is she a couple of years older than Tom Cruise, but she's also picked up a significant amount of weight. and people are just basically, you know, they're making fun of her and all this other crap. It's quite disgusting, quite honestly. Kelly McGillis is who I'm talking about, by the way. It's quite disgusting how people were. But I'm going, wow, you guys are tripping over her. I'm going, well, what about Viper? What about fucking Viper portrayed by Tom Skerritt? What about him? You know, he still looks, for a guy that's, I think, around 90 now, or at least in his 80s, you know, he still looks pretty recognizable and all of that other shit. There's a couple other people that I was thinking about wondering, well, what happened with their respective character and all that? But I thought the movie was fantastic. What was really a nice haul was the fact that Tom Cruise appears before the start of the movie, thanking you for going out of your way to see it and all of that. And I thought that was a nice little personal touch that he did and everything.
Agreed.
Go ahead.
Agreed. You know, the funny thing is, it's been a long time since I've seen that Top Gun, the first one. But I do remember bits and pieces. But you don't really need to see it. I mean, it's a great companion piece. No, don't get me wrong. And you probably should. But you don't need like a refresher. If you want to go see this as a standalone project, you could do that. Fantastic. There has not been a movie that's taking me on that type of a journey in a long time. That has got me 100% invested in the storytelling, in the movie, and is taking me into that world with them. It's fantastic. I mean, I can't even culminate how much hard work and the people that they got to play the parts. It couldn't have been done better. Really, I mean, everybody carried their weight as much as humanly possible. They all did their parts. You know, it was highs, lows, adrenaline rush. It was everything. There's nothing in that movie that you would want that you didn't get in reference to the feeling of what you were feeling. And it just, I mean, almost to the point, and I haven't done this in a long time either, almost to the point where I almost wanted to go back and see it again. You know, just because it was just that good. And like I said, the actors that portrayed who they portrayed, shout out to, you'll know who I'm talking about.
You're talking about Rooster.
Yes.
Okay. Rooster. Keep talking. I'll figure it out.
So, with that.
Miles Teller.
Yep. Miles Teller. So Rooster's the actor who portrays Rooster, and just, you know, fantastic. You know, the shots that they were able to get, the story that they were able to tell and really make it believable almost to the point that I heard in one of the articles I read, which was that same actor said at one point when he was in with Tom that he said, I forgot all my acting abilities and truly thought I was going to die. And he was like, you know, to the point I have such an appreciation for just low level, normal flying.
Interesting. Yeah, it's very rare, though, you come across a movie, let alone a sequel, and you're like, okay, it's a sequel, but, you know, most cases, it wasn't as good as the original. Nothing beats the original.
Mm-hmm.
You know, right down to the point, we just heard that a green light has been given for Joker 2, and there's pictures floating around of Joaquin Phoenix with the script in hand. It's a black and white image. And you're just going, man, well, wow, can't believe they're actually going to do this. But hey, you just hope that it's going to be a banger. It's going to be interesting to see what happens. But very seldom do you get a sequel that's as good as the original or surpasses the original. And I think yes. greatest examples of that in recent memory, you look at when there was a sequel to American Psycho 2. That thing was bad. How bad was it? It pretty much had went straight to DVD.
Yeah.
That's how bad it freaking was, right down to the point. Most people aren't even aware to this day that there was an American Psycho 2.
Mm-hmm.
You think about the sequel to A Christmas Story, the original. There actually was a sequel to A Christmas Story. If I'm not mistaken, the guy that was doing the original narration, he did come back for it. But as far as the initial cast, the live action cast, far as I remember, nobody had reprised their role. I'd be shocked to hear if, no, correction, Lee, the dad actually reprised. I'd be shocked to hear, but as far as I know, nobody had reprised their role. That had freaking bombed to my point. So there are sequels where you just go, like you see Maverick, you go, okay, you hear that there's going to be an Avatar 2, you go, well, if anybody can pull it off, James Cameron, he's the king. Mm-hmm. He definitely would be able to pull it off. Just give him the respected time that he needs and he can probably pull it up. But Maverick, you know, I just thought the way Tom Cruise and crew really went about, number one, taking their time, really trying to tell the right story. And to the point, some of you guys may remember this, but many years ago, when rumors first were out there that there was going to be a Top Gun sequel, me and Tams talked about it on one of the shows. And I said, well, not for nothing, they've got enough of a blueprint. And I said, you could do something with the goose's son character. You could do something with him. Maybe he's trying to follow in his son, in his father's footsteps. And Maverick ain't really trying to have anything to do with that. He's trying to stop him for what it's worth. And I couldn't add any more elements to that main story outside of that. But that pretty much was my main pitch. And to see that, that's basically the blueprint that they went with and the way that they went about not only telling the story, but the sub chapters all belonging to the main plot in which they were telling the story. Yep. They did a phenomenal job in execution. And I thought it was badass. I thought it was badass. So definitely I would highly recommend too that when you see this, if you're big on the graphics, see it in the best high resolution quality that's possible. Okay, if you're not a DVD collector, you want the best viewing experience, movie experience that's possible, then I would definitely encourage you to see it in IMAX 3D. Definitely see it in IMAX 3D.
Or just IMAX.
Yeah, don't see it in standard because you'll be cheating yourself, because I did feel a little bit cheated when we came out of there.
Go see it again.
I don't know if I really want to spend, you know, because nowadays it's what? 35 a head? I don't know. I don't know about that. I'd rather sit on that money, wait for the DVD to come out in 4K.
And yeah, but do you really think you won't? You're not going to get the experience that you get with IMAX because there's a lot more to it.
I tell you what, I love watching what I'm able to watch on that big ass TV.
Oh, I agree.
With the sound and but for people that haven't seen it, I would definitely say for them, if they're willing to shell out the cash and they don't care about owning the DVD, go see it in IMAX or IMAX 3D.
Definitely. Agreed.
Yeah, for me, the way I look at it now, it's okay, I spend this. But then what if I like it so much, I want to get the DVD, then I can't help but tally up how much money has been thrown out there. So let's say, for example, okay, no, we saw it in IMAX 3D. Okay, so we spent about $30 a head. So that's 60 right there. And then you turn around, what, 90 days later to get the DVD, that's probably going to be about maybe $30? 4K? Like, do you, right? So that's $90 that you don't drop. Where don't you think it makes right? You know, so you kind of, I mean, teach a song, but that's just how I always look at it. I gotta be really, really, yo, I don't give a fuck. I gotta see it. I'm just a fanatic. I gotta gimme. I'll watch it in 3D. I'll watch it in IMAX. I'll watch it, you know, Give me them 3D glasses. I'll, you know, whatever. But yeah, jump out there. See it when you guys get a chance. It's definitely a phenomenal movie. Great start to the summer. Honestly, a great start to the summer. I know next month we got Thor, Love and Thunder. The Buzz Lightyear movie is getting ready to drop later this month.
Isn't Black Adam coming out? Is that later?
I think that's later this year. I know a trailer, Dwayne The Rock Johnson had dropped a trailer, but I want to say maybe that's later this year. Look, the people at Warner Brothers, they got to figure out what to do with dude that's the Flash, because it's getting much worse for him. Have you heard now that apparently there's some investigation that's going on where apparently, and the police, they want him for questioning, but he fucking disappeared off the face of the planet. Apparently he is accused of grooming for X amount of years. Just the amazing amount of shit. Yeah. I don't know how many of you guys heard about that, but if I were Warner Brothers, I would just, you know what? We just need to recast, get as far away. Yeah. Of course, that would mean they're going to have to, oh my God, just the multiple scenes that they're going to, you might as well just start from scratch. That's my whole point.
Right. That's why I say either change the cast and or table it for a while and then recast.
Yeah.
Those are really your only options in reference to having people, you know, kind of not forget, but kind of put it on the back burner of their mind. But that's craziness.
I mean, he is not handling, let me tell you something, he is not handling the fame and the fortunes as he should be. He's not worthy of being in that position, quite honestly, because just look at everything that's gone down with him in recent months. I mean, he's been arrested or taken into custody many times, whether it's for harassment, disorderly conduct, a traffic violation. You had a couple of Hawaii residents that have filed temporary restraining orders against him after he allegedly broke into, you know, some couple's bedroom and tried to steal their passports and wallets. Now, that restraining order was later dropped, but this continuing odd behavior, it's made people question his health and well-being and his
mental status.
Right. There was footage of him choking out a woman outside of a bar in Iceland.
Wow.
Yeah.
When you become that type of famous, you have to let go of some things in reference to things that you can't do, because you are always on stage. Always, 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 always.
Yeah, apparently the parents of an 18-year-old North Dakota activist have filed for a protective order on behalf of their child, who they say the actor has groomed and controlled for several years. Attorney and activist Chase Iron Eyes and pediatrician Sarah Jumping Eagle claim their child is struggling with mental health after being groomed by Miller and given a large dose of LSD this year.
I was wondering if he went on drugs.
Legal documents filed in the Standing Rock Sykes Tribal Court and provided to Erza uses violence, intimidation, threat of violence, fear, paranoia, delusions, and drugs to hold sway over a young adolescent, the filing claims. Basically, he's accused of brainwashing this kid, ensured that this kid is without a phone and has given his bank card to another of his workers. I mean, just some weird, you know, Warner Brothers.
Well, if you're giving LSD, if you're giving out LSD, 9 times out of 10, you're taking it.
Look,
that essentially would explain all that shit.
My whole thing, though, is there are just too many instances in black and white. Here are the facts. Yes. We've got you in black and white. I don't understand why Warner Brothers is still being very quiet about this. They need to get in front of this. And yo, this guy has nothing to do with our franchise. Mm-hmm. As much as it pains us, because look, the Flash movie ain't supposed to go down, I think, not until summer of next year. So the sooner that they get on this now, can his ass, and just reshoot the scenes, the fucking better. They just need to go ahead and fucking do it already.
Yeah.
Why have all this baggage?
Because at this point, there has to be some level of, we've already spent this amount of money, but still, if you, even if you have spent that kind of money, do you really want that to be the face of the character you're putting on the big screen?
Right.
That's going to be some confused people.
And the hell with the fact, notice, we never took any shots or any issues with his sexual orientation, because he looks at himself as queer, he sometimes looks at himself as a she. He has dressed very provocatively, and to the point you go, wait, this dude is playing one of the most iconic DC characters that ever existed. And you just go, whoa, that's wow. And Warner Brothers is right. Some people may not say this out loud, but you know that there are a lot of people that are thinking it, which is, wait, he's playing this character and Warner Brothers doesn't have an issue. You know, well, when you're being respectful, you know, about it, you know, you're bringing dignity to, right? You know, when you're treating it not in a look at me, look what I'm doing, right? When you're not doing it like in a George Michael type of way. Remember yes. at one point in George Michael's career, he went about it kind of tasteless.
Yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. He went about it in a tasteless kind of way once it was revealed that he was gay.
Mm-hmm.
And you're kind of like, you know, all right, dude, whatever makes you happy, just keep giving us the good music, okay? And, but he, Erza Miller, he's been pretty like, okay, cool. But all this other shit, nah, you're going to have to miss me with all that.
Yeah.
You're going to have to miss me with all that. We talking about grooming little kids, I mean, now? Like, Warner Brothers, like, you know, you got a responsibility to shareholders, stockholders. Yes. You got a responsibility to your fans that you are hoping will continue to be invested in your franchises and all that, your Superman, your Batmans and all that. You know, you need to show that this type of behavior
is not tolerated.
Is not tolerated.
And right now you're showing them the exact opposite. Right.
If you can almost be a dick to Ben Affleck and all the struggles that he was going through as Batman, and ultimately you decided you wanted to phase him out for whatever respected reasons, I need that same energy. Absolutely. I need that same consistency for this.
I absolutely agree. I absolutely agree.
It's bullshit.
It is.
It's bullshit.
It is. Yeah, that's the, no.
They need to be. His career is over. I have a feeling his career is over. You know what this almost reminds me of? Just minus the grooming of the little kid and all that. It almost reminds me of the whole Pee Wee Herman incident. Remember when Pee Wee Herman, great image, great, you know, something for all ages.
Uh-huh.
And then until he got caught in the
movie, in the movie theaters.
When he was caught beating off.
Yep.
His career went down the tubes. Yeah, his career was fucked. He had to go about rebranding himself, but it didn't come overnight.
And even now, not now, but even through his time in trying to rebrand himself, it was no small feat, number one. And number two, he never got to the level nor the status that he was at one time.
Yeah.
Never.
It's hard to believe it, but for younger listeners, Paul Rubin, it's hard to believe, but he was actually a pop icon figure.
Yes, he was.
I remember when they had him featured in the Just Say No to Drugs campaign.
Mm-hmm.
Drugs is very bad and you shouldn't do it. It's just wrong. Say no to drugs. You know, they had him.
Yep.
You look back on it now and you're like, who's this dude with the ruby red lips?
And the ruby red tie.
Yeah, like, who the fuck is this guy, right?
So, kind of to put a book in on that, and guys, in reference to, I mean, most of, you know, you guys already know, but the personification of that character that they're playing a lot of times is not the actual person.
I think the greatest example and testament to that is look at the dad from Seventh Heaven.
Yeah. Agreed.
Wow. What a wholesome fucking, you know.
Yep.
I remember I watched that show religiously. I never missed a fucking episode. And I remember of the characters I gravitated towards. I like that dad.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't care that he happened to be a pastor and, you know, because sometimes you'll get one of those goody-goody two-shoe shows and it's okay, you're forcing the religion, you're forcing. But the way that they went about it on the show, it was, you know, they were very, mellow. What's the right word? Mellow and respectful in the way that they, right? It was, and then to learn that the dad was doing what he was doing.
Right.
Right? Isn't it interesting? Isn't it interesting? The level of scrutiny and all that, that guy went under.
Mm-hmm.
And he hasn't recovered since.
Mm-hmm.
No different than Bill Cosby. And yet Bill Cosby divided so many people.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Now you could say to me, "Oh, it's a completely different beast, Lee, but very similar paths."
Yeah.
Very similar outcomes as far as the controversies that surrounded them that they were involved in and how their respective careers hasn't been quite the same since. Mm-hmm. But the bigger difference would be that Cosby has had an impact and he's been the very fabric of all things pop culture for many decades, whereas the dad from Seventh Heaven, no.
And many, many years of cover-up.
Yeah.
With Cosby.
Yeah.
You know, of, hey, don't say anything. And, you know, well, half of them were under the influence of some form of drugs. So they remember it. They don't remember it. You know, should I say something? Shouldn't I say something? So there were so many other layers there, but very similar path for both. And the funny thing is with Cosby kind of reiterating, is there's so much division even now to whether he did or didn't. And people some people to this day still think he didn't. It's kind of like OJ. Not getting started on that, but in reference to the division on did he or didn't he?
Yeah.
So,
but this dude, this dude's career, it's never going to be the same.
Oh no.
You know, one fire. Okay. Two fires. Okay. You a little bad boy. Okay. Sure. But right. You know, once it's three and up and then we keep upping the ante.
Right.
We're now talking about grooming little kids.
Right. So you did that to one. Did you do it to others?
Right. Right.
How do we know? And yeah.
If I am, let me tell you something. I'm going to say this on this note. Put a pretty little ribbon around this. If I am the publicist for Michael Keaton, for Ben Affleck, I'm going, yo, what are we going to do about this? My clients don't want to have any attachment to. So what are we going to do about this? Because
it's in their due.
Right.
Just to do that.
Can you just imagine going with this movie now that it's in the books? Can you just imagine the media blitz and how Affleck and them are going to have to try to make sure that they avoid. But you know, there's going to be some motherfucker that's going to try to play a gotcha. Yeah. Or, yeah, I won't ask those questions. Or, I won't ask those questions. And then once they go live, right.
Yeah.
You know somebody's going to try. So before any of that fucking shit goes down. Look, I'm going to make a bold prediction. I've been pretty accurate before with a lot of things. If. I'm going to say this. If Warner Brothers has not benched this dude before the end of summer. So I'm going to say before the end of September. If they have not benched this dude by September so that they can recast the movie, look for the movie to be shelved. I'm sure Warner Brothers is weighing it very, very.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm sure they are right now. Right. Because that's money, wasted money that you've spent. And right. I get it. But if they don't can him and replace him by September, look for the movie to be shown.
I agree. As it should be, Because if you're thinking of even releasing this as it stands now, there's going to be people who are, first of all, going to boycott the movie. Mm-hmm. Because they're not going to take their child to see a freaking predator.
Right.
Number one. Number two, just the whole cloud that surrounds him. Mm-hmm. Not even just, I mean, the predator's enough.
Yeah.
But you've got so much other stuff. And yeah, they would be a fool to release it if they don't recast.
They would. They would. They would. Now, as far as who they could get to, you know, recast, I've seen some of the names that's being thrown around. Honestly, I thought he did such a pretty good job. I thought he did such a pretty good job in Top Gun Maverick. I personally would not mind seeing our boy Miles Teller get the nod. Hmm. I can picture him clean shaven, and you could either get him. Mm-hmm. Or you could get the dude that's on the Flash TV show. He's done a pretty good job making sure his name hasn't been involved in any type of controversy and all that other shit. You could maybe do something with him. Mm-hmm. You already did a crossover episode between him and the DC Erza Miller's Flash character. If I read the reports right from some months back, he had already did some type of a crossover with the two of them. So, I mean, you definitely got some options that's there, to my whole point. You got options. Just depends on, first of all, how young do you want to make this Flash character be? Do you want to, you know, recast, you know, the name of the character, or you want to bring in a new Flash? Do you maybe want to say that this Miller's Flash character, do you want to maybe say his Flash character died? And a new Flash comes to the scene, right? Like how, because remember, this Flash movie that's getting ready to drop, hopefully will drop, just with recasting, this is supposed to be a hard reset, because by the movie's end, going forward, they're supposed to have Michael Keaton's Batman basically be the Samuel Jackson you know, of Batman going forward, and he's pretty much going to be making appearances throughout other DC movies, right? So they're a little bit inspired by what they saw over on the Marvel side, and they're trying to, you know,
weave that in.
Right. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you're going to play that with him, then, you know, you got some options there. Yeah, because supposedly the way this is going to end, all we know right now is this is it for Ben Affleck and his version of Batman. So that's got a lot of people wondering, well, shit, does his Batman get killed, or, you know, does his Batman get lost in time or something? What exactly? And then you got these other reports that's talking about how Warner Brothers executives, they are paying attention to the numbers for everything that's been happening with the Zack Snyder the Zack Snyder Justice League cut and everything, and supposedly they like what they see, and they want for Ben Affleck to continue being Batman. They just are now going to group him under the DC Comics division of independent films. That's pretty much, you know, your Joker with Phoenix. They're thinking, okay, we can maybe continue it this way. Right. So there's a lot of stuff that's up in the air right now. But yeah, the sooner, silence is not good. The fact that they continue to be silent on this, not good whatsoever. So some food for thought right there. Let us know what you think, good, kind people. But on that note, we're going to go ahead, stick a fork in it, and call this episode D-O-N-E done. We hope you enjoyed this edition of Wrestling with the Topics. If you haven't done so already, make sure you're following us all through our social media, the Twitter, the Facebook, the Instagram, the TikTok. Use the keywords RCWR show. We got episodes available for you guys wherever you get your podcast. Show the YouTube channel a lot of love as well. And yeah, that is going to do it. She's the beautiful and the lovely Tammy. Lee Sanders here. We're wishing all of you all to be safe, and most importantly, be kind to one another. And we'll see you guys next go round. Adios, y'all, and take care.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening. An Infinity One Productions presentation. Keeping it honest, insightful, and interactive.